Good morning, everyone. So today we are going to cover in this lecture junction field effect transistors. And I should make a sort of generic comment before we begin. And that is, these lectures are actually not sort of full-fledged, you know, classroom lectures. And that's because you already know many of these things. It is essentially to present a way, maybe a different way, to cover some of this material, right? And in a way, it sort of explains, it also illustrates the philosophy of teaching that we follow here in IIT Bombay. And we thought everybody could benefit from that a little bit. So teaching is, we always feel that teaching is not really about, you know, giving some formulas and say, okay, here is a formula, and then mug it up and write in the exam, you'll get marks. That is exactly the opposite of teaching. That is what we believe. And therefore, we want to do things in a different way, and hopefully at least some of you will be able to follow this in your teaching. So teaching, we think, is like more about, you know, thinking, and not just thinking yourself, but also making your students think. And for that to happen, the student should feel that there is a link between what he or she has already learned in the past and what he is going to learn, he or she is going to learn today. So that is something that we always keep in mind, and that gives the student some confidence that he or she also can, you know, understand the development of a topic and not just sort of mug it up and write and get marks. Okay, that's the last thing that is of importance. All right, so let's I will talk about JFETs in this particular lecture, and of course let's begin. Okay. So before we even get down to the structure of a junction field effect transistor, the student should really know what is a transistor. I mean, what is the basic job of a transistor? And that is illustrated in this figure. A transistor is, to differentiate it from a diode or a resistor, it's essentially a, first of all, it's a three-terminal device. Second, there is a conduction between source and drain, and that conduction is controlled by the gate terminal. Okay, so that is the essence of transistor action. And then, of course, you can have various transistors. There are field effect transistors, there are bipolar junction transistors. The field effect transistors are of various categories and so on. But essentially, the idea is this. There is a resistance, it's not a constant resistance, between the source and drain, and that is controllable by a voltage that you apply on the gate terminal. So this is something that we feel must be step number one in sort of illustrating a transistor, any kind of transistor, that there is a, the current is going to vary between source and drain on two counts. One is the drain voltage itself, and the resistance itself is getting controlled by the gate. So the drain current is going to depend both on the gate voltage as well as the drain voltage. So just like I said, a field effect transistor has a gate terminal which controls the current flow between the other two terminals, that is the source and the drain. So in simple terms, and that is why, that is what must appear before any equation appears, in simple terms, of an FET can be thought of as a resistance connected between the source and drain, which is a function of the gate voltage. Right? That is the basic operation of a field effect transistor. And what do you do with it, etc. These are questions that will come later in applications, digital circuits, analog circuits, what have you. All right. The pointer. Now, as I said, the mechanism of the gate control would be different in different devices. For example, in junction field effect transistors, as we know, it is a P plus N, a PN junction that controls the resistance. In MESFET, it's a Schottky barrier that controls the resistance between source and drain. MOSFET, it's again controlled by gate, but there's an oxide and there's an inversion charge and so on. High electron mobility transistor, similar to MOSFET. All right. So FETs can be used for both analog and digital applications. In each case, the fact that the gate is used to control current flow between source and drain plays an extremely crucial role, and that is why you must have these transistors, and a diode, for example, will not be able to do the same job, no matter what you do, because it's a two-terminal device, and it has its intrinsic limitations. Okay, so now we proceed to the structure of a junction field effect transistor, and this again it's better to show a three-dimensional view first so that the students get an idea of what a real structure looks like, and then you can go to a cross section. If you directly jump to a cross section, students often get confused. They don't know what it looks like in 3D. All right, so here is a figure that shows a transistor in three dimensions. There is it's like basically a rectangular it's a cuboid, you can say. There is a source terminal at one end, drain terminal at another end, and the gate terminal is actually the both the top and the bottom. These are connected together, and that is the gate. Once the student gets this picture clear, it's much easier for him or her to understand the cross sectional view. All right, so next we go to the cross sectional view, and that's here. In the cross sectional view, it's important to show the P plus regions. So what we have here is the channel or the conduction channel is N type silicon, that's marked over there. And the device you can see, you should explain to students that it's actually a symmetric device. There's an axis and things are symmetric around that axis. The channel width, or the this would not be called width, this would be called the channel thickness, is 2 times A, where A is each one of these dimensions, and it's 2A because of again symmetry. All right, so what happens essentially, and that will be shown in the next slide, is there is a depletion region which will reduce the channel thickness and so on. So even this is a little more complicated than what the very, very basic device structure should have, and that is because it has got these neutral regions near the source and drain, and it's best not to confuse matters with these neutral regions in the beginning. So let's represent the same cross sectional view with a simplified structure, and that is here. Okay. So here we don't worry about this source, these regions near the source and drain, but just truncate that, and of course we can add that later. Fine. So this is the structure. And that is, as I was saying, this is a simplified structure in which we don't worry about the source and drain regions. The purple region here is the P plus region, and the channel region itself is N. So there is a P plus N junction at the top, as well as a P plus N junction at the bottom. Okay? So that is the basic structure. The important things here is the doping of this N region or the channel region, the length from source to drain, and the channel thickness, which is called 2A here, where A is half of this, that is, and it's 2A because of the symmetry. All right, so let's go to the next slide. Okay, so the important things to take from this slide is the n-type region between the top and bottom P plus region offers a resistance to current flow, and the resistance will depend on VGA, and that of course we want to see. So again, make things as simple as possible first, and then make them complicated later, so that the students get a feel for, you know, the basics first, and then get an idea of how things are in real life. Right? So the very simple case that we can first consider is when the drain voltage as well as the source voltage are both zero. Okay, so that is the first case we will consider. Okay, and that shows this particular situation. And maybe I should expand this so that you can see it better. Okay, so let's concentrate first on the gate voltage equal to 0 volts. And as somebody was pointing out, I should go slow now. So let's take VG equal to 0 volts, and in all of these figures, note that the source is grounded, the drain is grounded. In this particular case, gate voltage is also 0 volts. Right? So what is the situation at 0 volts? We have this P plus region, the purple one. Next to that, there is a blue region, and that's the depletion region. Right? And this is very important because some textbooks actually don't point this out. Okay, so there is this purple region which is the P plus region, and next to that there is this blue region which is the depletion region. And even note that even if your gate voltage is 0 volts, there is still a depletion region, and that's because of the built-in potential between the P plus of the P plus N junction. Okay, so there is, it's not as if you have a gate voltage of 0 volts, the depletion region is not there, it's not at all like that. And very often, some of the textbooks I've seen don't make this very clear, and that can be confusing. Okay, next to that, and of course, both the top and bottom are symmetric, so that's one thing that must be noticed as well. Next to that is a light blue region, and that region is essentially the n-type silicon which has got electrons. Okay, so the depletion region does not have any electrons or holes, or extremely small number, which is insignificant, so they don't participate in conduction. The light blue region is actually of importance, also is of interest as far as conduction from source to drain is concerned, because that is essentially neutral. That means it has got as many ions as there are electrons, and the electrons are free to move. So that is really the region of interest. Okay, and the dimensions, this A of course is the half channel thickness, that is fixed. This W is the depletion region width, that will obviously depend on the gate voltage. H is the width of the, or the thickness of the neutral region, again half thickness of the neutral region. Okay, so this, and of course H and W are both dependent on the gate voltage, such that H plus W will always be A. Okay, let's go to the next figure. The only difference between this and this is that the gate voltage is now made more negative. So here is 0 volts, here is let's say minus 1 volt. So as a result, what has happened is the depletion width, so the junction is now more reverse biased, and the depletion width has increased, and therefore it has eaten up into the channel, right? So the thickness of the channel that is available to you has now decreased. Okay? So that is very clear in this figure, and so on. So once the student understands this point, it's easy to go forward. And if you increase this gate voltage, or rather make it more negative, obviously you're going to get more of the depletion region and less of the channel region. And of course, at some point, what's going to happen is that this whole channel is going to disappear, because the depletion region, the top and the bottom depletion regions will just simply merge with each other. And that situation, of course, is called the pinch off situation. Okay. So essentially, the point is that as the reverse bias across the junction is increased by making VG more negative, the depletion region widens, as we have seen here, and the resistance offered by the N region increases, because now you are the width of the N region becomes smaller and smaller, and therefore the resistance increases. And that is essentially the operation of a junction field effect transistor. So that is the mechanism by which the channel resistance depends on the gate voltage in a junction field effect transistor. Finally, when the reverse bias becomes large enough, the depletion region consumes the entire N region. And that is a little bit away from this one, when all of this depletion region will just be one, and the channel becomes pinched off. And the voltage that corresponds to that particular situation is called the pinch off voltage. And that of course is a very important parameter for a JFET. All right, so now let's get to this pinch off voltage. Let's see how we can calculate that. And again, when you're teaching in the class, you can say, okay, the formula for the pinch off voltage is so and so. That's not a very satisfactory thing to do, because the students will always have a lingering, you know, doubt in their mind, where did this come from? And they will think that it has just sort of fallen from the heavens and you have to just take it for granted, or what. And in fact, it is not like that at all. It's very simple to derive, and therefore it's always a good idea to derive it in front of the students, so that they develop some confidence that things can be derived and not just mugged up. Very important. Okay, so and how do you derive this? That's in this slide. So what is the pinch off voltage basically? It is the gate voltage for which this H becomes 0, or in other words, this W becomes equal to A. That is the pinch off voltage. So if you know the dependence of W on VG, just equate that to A and you get your pinch off voltage, as simple as that. There is no reason why this should not be derived in class. It must be derived in class so that students develop a better understanding. Okay. So, So what is W for a P plus N junction? The depletion region actually extends both into the P plus region as well as the N region. And if it's P plus, that means it's much, the P region is much more heavily doped than the N region. And therefore, it's a fair assumption to say that all of this, all of the depletion region basically is in the N region and not at all in the P plus region. That will be extremely small. So we just ignore that part. And we say then that the W depletion width here is given by this P plus N junction expression. And what does it have? It has got epsilon for silicon, which is 11.7 times epsilon 0. Then it has got the built-in voltage. The built-in voltage will actually depend on the doping of the P plus N region, the doping of the N region. This is something like 0.8 volts, 0.9 volts, 0.95 volts and so on of that order. V is the difference, is the potential difference between the P plus and N. In this case, your P plus is sitting at VG and N is sitting at 0 volts because your source and drain, everything is at 0 volts. So that is what V is. So V is simply VG in this case. Q is the electronic charge and D is the doping density of in the channel. Typically 10 raised to 15, 10 raised to 16 per centimeter cube. Okay, so it's a simple matter now to put this W here and then find out what VG is, and that VG will be the same as the pinch off voltage. So then we substitute this W here and that's it, and then you get the pinch off voltage equal to VBI minus, let me just zoom on this. Okay, then we get this VP equal to the built in voltage minus Q and D A squared by 2 epsilon. Now, problems with some of the textbooks. Okay, they say that assume VBI equal to 0. Why? Nobody knows. I certainly don't know why. Okay, because it is not really negligible compared to that term, as we will see. Okay, so that's a silly thing to say, that ignore VBI. Okay, and you should not say that. Q and D A squared by 2 epsilon. So of these, Q and epsilon are just physical constants. You really can't do anything about that. But ND and A squared are in the control of the fabrication person, right? So when the device is being fabricated, you can control ND or you can control and you can control A to get the desired value of pinch off voltage. And note that this dependence on A is rather strong because of the square here, okay? Whereas ND comes with the linear dependence. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So now in the next slide, we have a sample calculation of the pinch off voltage. Okay, this structure is the same as before, we don't need to zoom that. Okay, so here is the formula is reproduced. All right. So an example, and this is always, I'm showing this because it's always a good practice. Whenever you give a formula in class, it's always good to put some numbers so that it helps the students to get these things fixed in their minds. Then they can connect these formulas to actual numbers, and it really helps a lot. And not only the numbers, it also helps them to think about the units of each of these quantities, and that's very important. Okay, so let's, so in this example, we compute the pinch off voltage for an ND of 2 10 raised to 15 per centimeter cube. A, the half channel thickness of 1.5 micron, and the built-in voltage, a given built-in voltage of 0.8 volts. All right. So let's go further. Okay, now the reason this is actually a simple calculation, but the reason I put this in this slide is to illustrate know the units of each quantity, and it's very important that the units are used consistently, so that you don't end up with, you know, 3.48 million volts or 3.48 microvolts and so on, and that can happen. I've seen that in answer papers. So it's very important that you bring this point out very clearly in class. So Q, 1.6 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb, and you should actually ask the students to tell you what Q is, and if they don't know the value of Q, they should leave the class and know the value of Q and come back, maybe. So Q is something that everybody must know. Epsilon 0, 8.85 10 raised to minus 14 farad per centimeter, that is something that everybody should know. 11.7 is the epsilon for silicon, something that everybody must know. And these are all constants basically. And so what are the variables? 2 10 raised to 15 per centimeter cube, that is the doping density. And 1.5 micron, now this is very important. We need to convert this micron into centimeter so that the units work out well. So, and that conversion is 10 raised to minus 4. And then you should actually show this in class. You have centimeter raised to minus 3 there, centimeter squared here, and this is, there is a per centimeter in the denominator. So all the centimeters will actually cancel. You are left with coulomb divided by farad. Coulomb divided by farad is coulomb divided by coulomb by volt, and that is volt. Okay. So if you do this in class in this way an equivalent manner, then students actually begin to develop an appreciation for all the units and don't make mistakes later on. Okay. All right, so all this comes to 3.48 volts, and the built-in voltage is 0.8 volts, and so the net pinch-off voltage therefore is minus 2.7 volts for this device. What does it mean? It means that if you apply a gate voltage of minus 2.7 volts, this channel will get pinched off, and you will see a very large resistance between source and drain. That is what happens at pinch-off. Okay, things are of course different if you apply a drain voltage, and we will come to that later. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, we'll continue with I think there may be some questions, but we'll take them at the end. All right, so the pinch off voltage in this particular case is minus 2.7 volts, and as I was saying, the built-in voltage of 0.8 here is certainly not negligible compared to this 3.5 volts, right? So therefore there is no particular reason, there is no good reason to ignore it, although some textbooks do that, and that's not proper. Okay, let's go ahead. And this is exactly what we said. If a gate voltage of minus 2.7 volts is applied, the channel gets pinched off, that is the resistance between the source and drain becomes very large. Okay, so that is that was with the gate drain voltage equal to 0, and now we need to consider the more general case of drain voltage not equal to 0, right? And we took this VD equal to 0 case earlier because it's much simpler to handle, and also gives the students a feel already of the pinch off voltage. Okay, so the pinch off voltage is something that you should that can be taught even before one talks about a non-zero drain voltage, because it's completely independent of the drain voltage. Okay, so let's go. Okay, to this slide. Let me zoom a little bit and just explain these figures first. Okay, so now here what we have is there is a certain gate voltage which is constant, and we're not going to vary that from this figure to that figure to the next figure. But what we are going to vary is the drain voltage. So in this particular example, in this particular figure, the drain voltage is 0 volts, and source voltage is also 0 volts. So there is nothing, there is all points in the channel are sitting at 0 volts, and there is no change as you go from x equal to 0 to x equal to L. It's all the same. You notice that this depletion width as well as the channel thickness H, they are also constant, that is irrespective, that is independent of X. Okay, that is because the drain voltage is at 0 volts. And this is the case we have already seen in the previous slides. Okay, now let us apply a small voltage, let's say 0.05 volts, that is 50 millivolts at the drain. So what happens now is the the reverse bias between the gate and the source is the gate voltage is some value, let's say -1. So this will be -1, -0, -1 here. Between the gate and the drain, the reverse bias would be -1, -0.05. So it will be -1.05. So here we have a reverse bias of 1. Here you have a reverse bias of 1.05. So the drain essentially is sitting at a larger reverse bias as compared to the drain, as compared to the source. As a result, what happens is the depletion region near the drain end is wider as compared to the source, and that is basically what the drain voltage will do. If you keep increasing the drain voltage, the depletion width, the depletion region width at the drain will increase, and of course the source width is not going to change because the source, we are not changing the source voltage. The gate voltage, remember, is a constant, let's say -1 volt. Okay, so this keeps on increasing, and therefore the channel thickness near the drain will keep on decreasing. And if you plot the potential between from source to drain along, let's say, this line, that would look something like this. So it is at 0 volts here, it is at 1 volt here, that's because you applied a 1 volt drain voltage, and it will vary in some manner. We don't know what that form is, but it will vary in some continuous manner between 0 and 1. Okay. So it is always good to show these pictures to students, explain to them qualitatively what happens, and then come to equations. If you jump to equations, it basically just becomes overhead transmission for them. Alright, so let's go to the next, consider an engine, so this we have already discussed. Okay, in this, so it's important to note that W and H are now functions of X, right, in this figure. Let me expand it again. So what we are saying is this W and H are both, so the W here is that much, W here is that much, W here is that much, and similarly H will change. So W and H are both functions of X now, it depends on where you are in the channel, but W plus H will always be equal, to A, that is what we are saying here. Alright, so the important point is that since the PN junction bias at a given X is VG minus the potential at that particular point, that is shown in this figure approximately, the drain end of the channel is sitting with a larger reverse bias than the source end, and therefore the depletion region is larger there, and therefore the channel is thinner. And now let's derive the ID equation. As I said, it's always good to derive this, and this derivation is a little more involved, but certainly something that you can do in class and you should do in class so that the students have some confidence in how things are done. Okay, so let me expand this figure. Okay, I hope after expansion is showing up alright at your end. So it is the same as same figure as before. I am in addition, we have shown here a cross section of the device so that the equation derivation becomes a little more clear to the students. Okay, so this is W, that is H. And if I just take this line over there, okay, and look at the cross section of the of this device, this light blue region actually is the region of conduction. Okay, the region next to that, the blue region, is actually useless as far as conduction is concerned because it's just a depletion region with no carriers. And of course, next to that is the P plus gate region. So the important area for the drain current calculation is just this light blue area. And what is the area, the cross-sectional area of that area there? It's 2H, that is this dimension, times Z, where Z is the device dimension in the direction perpendicular. All right, so let's begin the derivative. So consider a slice of this device that we have done here. The current density at any point in the neutral region is assumed to be in the X direction. Okay, that's very important. And that's a crucial assumption that must be made. And this is, of course, a very good assumption, and that's because normally this length is much larger than this A here, the channel thickness. And that's why this assumption is quite good. So what is the current given by? It is given by the usual drift term and the diffusion term. And in this device, in the junction field effect transistor, the doping density everywhere is the same, and the electron density is roughly equal to the doping density, and therefore the electron density everywhere in the channel is also the same, and therefore there is no derivative. This dN dx is just zero. Okay, so the diffusion term drops out, and you just get Q times mu n times ND times the electric field. And here, of course, you have to be careful with the signs. So E actually is minus dV by dx, but I have just put dV by dx there. Finally, we will introduce all these signs correctly. Okay, so we have neglected the diffusion current, since the electron density everywhere in the channel is roughly the same, that is equal to the doping density, and therefore dN dx is 0. When you differentiate this constant electron density, you will get a 0. So what is important in this figure? Note that only the neutral part of the N silicon conducts, that is the light blue region, since there are no carriers in the depletion region. So the depletion regions are essentially not contributing to any current at all. So at a given X, the current ID is obtained by integrating Jn over the area of the neutral channel region, that is this region here. Okay. And in this device, this Jn is actually the same everywhere in this area, and therefore the integral simply becomes the current density times this area. Okay, go over the slides later on and see if you have any doubts. We will go through this a little faster. Okay, so that is what it is. So there is this Jn which is integrated over this light blue area, and that area is simply 2H times Z, and then what you see in this bracket is nothing but Jn, and that is this. Right? So this Jn has been substituted right here, that's it. Okay, so ID at any given X, let's say at this point, is given by 2 times Q times Z times mu n times nd. All of these are constants, Q, Z, mu n, nd are all constants, times A, times the electric field there, dV dx, times H is nothing but A times 1 minus W by A. You can show that from the fact that H is basically A is H plus W, and this will follow from there. So let's look at this equation somewhat. So what it says is the current at any point x in the x direction is some constant times dV by dx, which depends on that particular x, and multiplied by 1 minus W by A. Now this factor is also dependent on x, because W itself is a function of x. And we know that this ID at this point is the same as ID at this point, is the same as ID at this point. So what happens in this device is that this dV dx and this 1 minus W by A, these two terms basically go on adjusting as x is changed, such that their product remains the same. And that must be the case, because we have the same current throughout the device. Okay. So all these things are good to know for the student. Next. So what do we do next? Now, of course, we don't like this dV by dx here, and we don't like this 1 minus W by A, because W is also a function of x. We want an expression for ID which is independent of dV by dx, etc. So let's see how to do that. And that is done by by using the fact that ID is actually constant from the source to drain, right? So ID is just a constant. And if I integrate ID as a function, ID dx from 0 to L, I'll simply get ID times L. Okay, so I can do that on this left side, and I can integrate this also with respect to x. And when I do that, this dV dx dx will give me integral with respect to dV, with respect to V, and I can replace the limits. Instead of putting limits on from 0 to L on x, I can put limits on V, the channel potential, from 0 to VD, and that is what this is. And notice that we have used, for this W, we have used this expression which we have seen before, where this VG, this VBI minus VG minus V is the net reverse bias across the P plus N junction. Okay. So the next step is to just carry out this integral. Okay, if you notice, this integral has got one here, can be easily integrated. 2 epsilon q and dA squared, all of these are constants, this will simply come out. VBI is a constant, VG is a constant, and then there is this minus V. Okay, so the integral will only involve this term, and it can be easily integrated. Square root of V, so you'll get V raised to 3 by 2 divided by 3 by 2 and so on, and with of course appropriate substitutions. Okay, so when you do all that, evaluating the integral and using this particular equation, we get, and of course it says do this, so you must do this on the board, or you must ask the students to do this as an assignment or something, and not just take it for granted. Okay, so when you do all this, you will get, if you want to put it in a nice form, you get this expression, where we have, notice that these quantities are now dimensionless. Okay, there is a voltage in the numerator, there is a voltage in the denominator. So there is a dimensionless ratio here, that is raised to 3 by 2. This is another dimensionless ratio, raised to 3 by 2. And it can be put in a nice compact form if you replace some of these constants with a quantity called G0, and that is G0 here. Q 2 times Q times Z times mu N times N D times A by L. Okay, all that is G0. Why do we call it G0? There is a good reason for that. But before we go to that, where is the VD dependence in this equation? ID equal to all of this. The VD dependence is basically here, VD, and here. Right? So that is important to point out. Where is the VG dependence? VG dependence is here and here. Okay, that is the VG dependence. Okay. All right, next. So let's see what this G0 is. So this G0 turns out that it is the channel conductance if there was no depletion. That means suppose you didn't have any depletion at all throughout, and if you calculate the resistance of this particular box, 1 over that resistance will give you G0. That's again something that you can very easily show. So that is the conductance of the channel if there was no depletion. That is, if H of X was A throughout. That means this H is equal to A throughout the channel. Okay, so that is more or less the derivation, and often this is not the equation that is shown in textbooks. What we show in textbooks is a simplified equation, and let's come to that now. Okay, next slide. So before we do that, it is good to consider a special case, and that is VD equal to 0 volts, right. So now we have this expression for ID, and we should see what does it look like if we make VD equal to 0. Obviously, the equation you have derived should apply for, should hold for the special case VD equal to 0. And why are we doing this? Because we already are familiar with this particular situation that we have done before we applied a non-zero drain voltage. So this is your the generic ID expression in terms of VG and VD. So how does it simplify? Okay, and this is something that the students can do as homework. So there is a VD here. This VD of course remains as it is. Okay, so there is a VD dependent term here, and this is the VD independent term, and you can actually expand this, you can carry out this Taylor series expansion and then show that it reduces to, if your VD is small, it reduces to this particular situation. Okay, then that turns out to be just this simplified format here. So now it is independent of VD, because VD is very small and it depends only on VG. And if you use some of these expressions that we have previously derived, you will see that this is nothing but G0 times VD times 1 minus W by A. Okay. Now this has a very nice interpretation, and is pretty trivial to show what it is. This simply shows that the channel conductance reduces linearly with W, as seen before, and we have done this before. The VES equal to VD equal to 0 volts case, this should be VD. So this is, it is good to know that this complicated expression reduces to something that we already are familiar with, and something we have seen before. Okay. Yeah. Now comes the very important question, that is, what does the IV characteristic look like? So if I plot this equation that we have derived, okay, as a function of, let's say I keep a VG equal to some constant value of VG, for example 0 volts here, right, put VG equal to 0 here, vary VD from let's say 0 to 5 volts and plot this. What I get is I get the current which rises and reaches a maximum at some point, okay. What happens beyond this point we don't know right now, but we will come to that later, okay. So that is the picture. If I apply a reverse bias, so this is 0 volts, if I apply a reverse bias of minus 1 volt, okay, then this whole IDVG will come down, IDVD will come down, and but again it will reach a maximum at a certain drain voltage, okay, that drain voltage. And so on, right. So now this is something that you should actually, if the students are willing, you should ask, actually ask them to write a program and generate this plot. It's very simple to write a program to do this. So what is the key here? For a given VG, ID reaches a maximum at what point? At VD equal to VG minus VP. Okay, now it's not obvious from this figure, but you can differentiate this equation with respect to VD and show that the maximum occurs for this particular condition, okay. Very simple differentiation. And so that is the take home point here. At this value of VD, the bias across the PN junction at the drain is, what is the bias across the PN junction? It is VG minus VD, and that turns out to be VP. And what is VP? VP has a significance. VP has the significance that it is a pinch off voltage, right? So the channel is pinched off at that particular point. So what it means is, at this value of VD, the bias across the PN junction at the drain end is VG minus VD equal to VP. In other words, the drain end of the channel has just reached pinch off. That is what has happened. And how do you show this pictorially? So here is a figure which shows that. Okay, so this is at this particular point, at this particular point, or this point, or this point, depending on the VG. This is the situation here. Okay. This is the situation. So at drain end, the depletion region, the top depletion region and the bottom depletion region are just merged with each other, and that is the pinch off situation denoted by this circle here. Okay. So let's go to the next slide. So the important question to ask now is, what happens if VD is increased further? So now we know more or less the story up to this point. What happens if I go on increasing this? What will happen to this particular region? Will the current just collapse? Of course, we know that it does not happen. It's important to explain why it does not happen. Okay. So it's good to show this kind of figure, right? So here we have, let me just get all these things and then expand. Okay, so here we have various situations. Here is the IV characteristics, ID versus VD. Here is a small VD, let's say, you know, 10 millivolts, 50 millivolts of that kind. And this situation corresponds to this point A here. Then we apply a larger VD, but still before, less than that particular value. Then you get this point B here. So that is the situation at that point. At C, as we have seen before, this drain end has just reached pinch off. That means the top depletion region and the bottom depletion region have just merged with each other. That is this situation D. Okay. What happens if I increase VD further? Okay. And of course, we know that we reach the saturation region. But why does it saturate? It's not very, it's certainly not very obvious for any student who is doing this for the first time. Therefore, it's very important to explain what happens in this saturation region. So what happens in saturation is that this region, this pinch off region, expands just a little bit, okay, and the excess voltage that we have now beyond BD sat, that all of that drops across this particular high field region. And so therefore, as you can see that this region here, the where there is a neutral channel, this region has not really changed all that much, and therefore the conditions in the channel are more or less the same, therefore the current is more or less the same, and that is what happens in saturation. Okay, all of these things are actually written over here. Okay, but it's very important to actually show these pictures. I either draw them on the board, or I just show them, just project it or whatever, and correlate that with an IV characteristics. Of course, all of this is at a particular VG. Otherwise, the students really, we often ask our the candidates who come for MTech examination, and we ask them why is the saturation happening. They often don't know the answer. It's very important to explain this. Okay, next slide. Okay, here is an example. It's very important to actually ask students to do something like this. So they develop some, they should start believing the equations rather than just mugging it up and writing in the exam and getting marks. Okay, and if they will start believing in equations only if they do something with the equations, and that is very important. And this is something that they can easily do. It's not really asking for much. Okay, here is a problem. An N channel silicon JFET has the following parameters at T equal to 300 K, that is room temperature. A equal to 1.5 micron, the channel, that is the half channel thickness. L is the device length, 5 micron. Z, that is the dimension in the direction perpendicular to the paper, 50 microns. ND, 2 10 to 15, VBI 0.8, and mobility is 300 centimeter squared per volt second. What is the pinch off voltage? This example, these numbers are the same as before, so the pinch off voltage is the same as what we saw earlier. And you should point out to the students that in this pinch off voltage calculation, this mobility will simply not enter, because we are not even talking about any conduction. We are just talking about a gate voltage at which the channel is completely pinched off, and that is simply coming from electrostatics, and there is no conduction coming into that at all. Okay, so where does the mobility actually come into picture? That of course comes into picture in IDVD characteristics. So question B is to write a program to generate IDVD characteristics for VG equal to 0, minus 0.5, minus 1, minus, etc. And for each of the above VG values, they need to compute VD sat, that means the VD value at which the channel gets pinched off or the drain current saturates, and show it on the IDVD plot. Of course, the part of an IDVD characteristic that corresponds to VD less than VD sat is called a linear region, and that corresponding to VD greater than VD sat is called the saturation region. So it's very easy to write this program, and students will feel much happier with the equation once they do this exercise. If they plot it, they should get something like this. So this is the IV characteristics. Of course, the equation is going to give you data only up to this point. After that, it is just constant. And this is the boundary between the linear and saturation regions. Okay. The linear and saturation region are also marked over here. Okay, so I think that is more or less all for this topic. I think there are just a couple of comments. Okay, so it's important to point out that very often we don't use this original equation because we are only interested in the saturation region, and there a simplification works quite fine, and that is very useful for approximate design of circuits and so on. So let's just go through this. Okay, so this is our original equation. And we are generally, especially if you are talking about analog circuits, we are only interested in the saturation current, right? So saturation happens when VD sat is VG minus VP. If you do that, this whole term becomes just one, and you are left with this expression. So that is the actual ID sat as it follows from our original equation. But it's a little complex because there is this 3/2 here and so on. So very often this following approximate model is found to be adequate in circuit design, and that is ID sat at a given VG is simply some constant ID SS 1 minus VG over VP squared. That's it. Okay. Where ID SS is nothing but the saturation current at VG equal to 0 volts. And in amplifier design, we are interested not in the actual current but in the slope of this ID with respect to VG at a constant VD. So that if that can be obtained easily from this equation, and that's what you get. Okay. So some students might get if you show this equation, some students might wonder where this comes from, because they would in textbooks they would probably see this equation. So it's important to point out that this is actually an approximation for what you get theoretically. Okay. Now, just one more slide, I think. On yeah. So now let's bring back the neutral source and drain regions, because as we said earlier, this part of the device is the so-called intrinsic part, but the actual device will also have some neutral regions here, which we can represent with some resistances. So if you want to model this whole thing accurately, then this is your intrinsic device, which will follow the equation that we derived. Then in addition, you have this source resistance here and a drain resistance here attached to it, and that becomes a more complete, maybe more accurate model. Okay. Very important to also talk about the small signal model, because if you are talking about an amplifier example like this, then it's important to know what the gain of this amplifier is, and that is where we need a small signal model. Okay, so a small signal model is required in analyzing an amplifier, its gain or even frequency response. And what is an appropriate model for a JFET? We notice that between the gate and source we have a P plus N junction. Between the gate and drain also we have a P plus N junction. That means very large resistances. And so these large resistances are so large that we don't even we can just treat them as open circuits. But apart from that, we also have a P plus, since it's a P plus N junction, apart from that, we also have a capacitance. And those are these capacitance. Between G and S, there is a capacitance CGS. Between G and D, there is a capacitance CGD. And these capacitances are actually important, because these will limit your limit the performance of your circuit at high frequencies. If the frequencies are low, then of course these are open circuits, and then they are not there. What is the other most important quantity? GM. The transconductance in the saturation region, that is DID DVG with PD equal to constant, and we already derived a little approximation for that earlier. So if you apply a VG here, the current, the small signal current here is GM times VG, where VG is the small signal voltage. In addition, in our derivation actually this, there is no resistance between this, between the drain and source, because after saturation we said the ID becomes constant. In practice, it is not quite constant, and there is a small resistance between drain and source, and 1 over that resistance is called GD. And this GD can actually limit the performance of an amplifier a little, somewhat. Okay. So that is the small signal equivalent model. And of course, whenever you talk about small signal equivalent model, it's good to tell the students why, you know, we want to talk about it even, right? And that is because we want to look at amplifiers. Okay, so let's go to, I think the next one is probably the last slide. Oh, this is the last slide. Okay. All right, so I can take some questions, and there's still some time remaining, and I wanted to talk a little bit about some other topic, but let's take some questions. Okay, if you have any questions, you can press the raise hand button. And we can, there are also some questions on in the chat mode, so I can take that now. All of these slides are available on the web, so you can just download, use them, and look at it in more detail. In what way analog switch using JFET differs from digital switch using JFET? JFETs actually are not really used in digital circuits these days, or even earlier, because there were better alternatives, either the BJT or the MOSFET. So there is no, really there is no such thing as JFET as a digital switch. It is used in, I know that it is used in some of the sample hold kind of circuits, and that is where, and that's because it can have a very large gate resistance, and it's the drain to source resistance you can control with by appropriately designed the device. But there is for low voltage applications, at least there is, I mean, the same job can also be done by MOSFETs these days. KJ Somaya.
You are shown in N channel, that region you are shown as a neutral, whereas when I am talking about the N type, so there is a majority carriers are electrons. So you can say that the number of electrons are more than number of holes, it is correct?
Number of electrons is of course more than number of holes. In the neutral region, the light blue region that we showed in the slides, the it's an n-type region, right? So nd of the order of 10 raised to 15 or 10 raised to 16 or 10 raised to 17, whatever. So and the electron density is roughly the same as the doping density. That is, if the doping density is 10 raised to 16, the electron density is also 10 raised to 16. And so the hole density will be much, much smaller than that, because n times p will be about ni squared. Okay, so if, and ni squared is like 10 raised to 20. So if your electron density is 10 raised to 16, the hole density will be 10 raised to 4, much, much, much smaller. Okay, that's why you don't even need to talk about it. Does that answer your question? Over.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
When you're talking about the PN junction, you're using the term barrier potential or cut-in voltage. But you are using here built-in potential. So as far as my knowledge is concerned, when I'm going for built-in potential term, so you are talking about the work function difference. Whereas you are in PN junction using the, you are using the term built-in potential.
Can I use this out?
Over.
Okay. Well, built-in potential and cut-in potentials are two entirely different things. What is the cut-in potential? If you plot I versus V for a diode, you get something like this. And of course, the current in the reverse direction is very, very small. And if you, well, actually it's, far, it's steeper than that. And if you extrapolate this, this is called the cut-in voltage or the turn-on voltage, right? Now, the built-in voltage that I talked about is completely different than this. So if you are familiar with the PN junction diagram, let's just take a PN junction in equilibrium. You have the p-type region here, the n-type region here. This is the boundary between the two. Rosa Sharma must have done these yesterday. Then you have the potential varying something like this, depending of course on the doping densities. This is flat, right? Okay. The built-in potential is basically the difference in potential between these two points. This is called built-in potential. Okay. Now, this is the situation in a PN junction, even if you don't have a reverse bias, right? And so, and this built-in potential is necessarily is responsible for a depletion region here, W depletion. Okay. So, in a JFET, even when you don't have a gate voltage applied, or when your gate voltage is zero, you still have a depletion region, and that is why we showed those little blue regions, no, after the P plus regions. What happens in a JFET is you have this VBI, and now you apply in addition a reverse bias. So what happens is this gets pulled down. Etc. And this becomes your net potential drop. As a result, of course, a lot of things will change. This picture is not very clear. The depletion region will also change. The depletion region will expand, and many things like that will happen. In a P plus N junction, what happens is that this part of the depletion region is negligible, right, compared to that one, because if you look at W depletion on the P side to W depletion on the N side, you get something like N D over N A. And if your N A in a P plus N junction is much larger than N A N D, then it is like 0. Okay, so therefore, in the JFET figure, we are not even bothered about this particular part on the P plus side. We are only worried about the N side. Okay, is that clear? So the cut-in voltage is something that comes into picture when the device turns on the PN junction. In the JFET, we are not allowing that to happen at all, because we are never going to forward bias the gate to source junction. Right? We are always going to operate that under reverse bias. So this is actually not relevant. This is what is relevant. Okay.
Sir, while showing the polarity for the built-in potential, it depends upon the work function difference. So it is like this key, let us say P having, let us say, 4 work function, and let us say N type having, let us say, 8. So shall I give the polarity positive to the N side who is having work function more than the P side? Or
in a P plus N junction, we actually don't talk about the work function. Work function we talk about for a metal semiconductor junction, not in a P plus N junction. So let me just draw a realistic band diagram for a P plus N junction. Okay. So if you have a voltage of 0 volts, this is what it looks like. So there is almost no depletion region in the P region, and the entire depletion region is on the N side. Okay, so there is no question of any work function. So this EC minus EF will depend on what is this doping density NA here. Okay, so this, what is the actual difference between this and that? You can go down like this. That is EC minus EF on the P side. You come back like this, then you come back like that, and then you come back like this. Okay, so that is the actual difference between this level and that level. And what is this EC minus EF here? That again will depend on what is the doping density. Okay, so of course the work function will be important if you are talking about a MESFET where the gate is a metal. So then the work function of the metal will come into picture. In this case, the work function is not really directly coming into picture, because these things are determined only by the doping densities. Let's take another. Mufakam College, you have any questions? Over.
In the difference amplifier shown using JFET, sir, you have used a pair of RGs, RG1 and RG2. Can you explain the need for these RGs? Over.
I'm not sure if I get the question. Let me see if I get your question correctly. Is your question about the source resistance and drain resistance like these? Over. Is your question about RS and RD? Yeah.
I'll repeat the question, sir. In the difference amplifier shown,
the
resistance named as RG1 and RG2. Can you explain the need for using this pair of resistances?
Okay. Yeah, well, that is actually not really in the context of this particular topic, it's not very important. But I believe these may be for some protection purpose. I'm not 100% sure. Okay, so there is one question about what happens at depletion region when breakdown occurs. Okay, there is a question about what happens to the depletion region when breakdown happens. So let's look at that part. All right, so when breakdown happens, the P plus N junction, the insulating region is the depletion region is not insulating anymore, but it actually will conduct large amounts. And as a result, your IV characteristics, the current will basically shoot up, and you would have seen that in data books and such. So if you keep on increasing the drain voltage, your the P plus N junction will keep getting more and more reverse biased. At some point, what will happen is this junction will simply break down, and then the current, the ID will start increasing dramatically. And of course, you never want to operate in that particular region. It's not useful for amplifiers or any digital circuits. So you always avoid that region. Can we find the number of electrons passing at one cross section for FET? Find the number of electrons passing at one cross section. Okay. Of course you can. It's very simple. Let's look at the cross section of the device. So the number of electrons crossing a particular area. What is the electron density at? So this, the light blue area is the one that you are talking about. So what is the number of? So you can take a small delta x here. Maybe I can just draw here. Okay. So let's say this is your, this is that light blue region. This dimension is 2 times h. This dimension is z. Your device actually is like this, in that direction. Okay. So what is the number of electrons crossing this, let's say, per unit time? So let's take a small slice here with a finite thickness delta x. Okay. Now in this particular area at a given time, what is the number of electrons that we have? The number of electrons here is the volume 2 times h times z times delta x multiplied by the electron density. The electron density over here throughout this area is equal to the doping density, because that region is a neutral region. So that is the number of electrons that are in this area at a given time t, right? Now we would like to know in how much time will all of these electrons leave this particular region. Okay, so let's calculate that delta t. So what is delta t equal to? Delta t is equal to the distance divided by velocity. What is the distance? What is the distance is delta x, and what is the velocity? Mu n times the electric field. I'm just talking about the magnitude, not the science. Okay. And so these many electrons in this volume leave this particular region in that much time. Okay, so per unit time, if you want to know, you need to just divide that by delta t. The unknown here is dv dx, and for that you need to actually solve the device equations inside the device, and that one can do by numerical solution, not analytically. There are some other questions, but the time is up. Okay. All right. So if your question has not been answered, you can, you're free to send it again on Moodle, and I will try to get back to you. Thanks for your attention, and I'll see you tomorrow again.